History of physics in a nutshell. But of course, that's physics of type 1. And I've also put that on the left hand side, different languages. We are used to using the Greek and Roman alphabet. A, B, C, alpha, beta, gamma. Y is Greek, gamma is Greek. So you're used to using Latin or Roman letters and Greek English. But you see, there's more to the world than Greek and Roman. Other languages, for example, Russian, all the Slavic languages use Cyrillic. Cyrillic is named after Cyril, and that's in red. So Cyrillic is, you know, a very common language. All the Russians here know Cyrillic, and people from other Slav countries. And so I've got that in that row, I've given that color red. Well, in the old days, red stood for communism and so on and so forth, but that's not really significant. So now in that row, I've got numbers underneath the ones above. And underneath, well, the R and the C, that column, you wonder what it stands for. Well, R and C stand for the real number of the complex. That's easy. And H, that stands for the quaternions of Hamilton. And O stands for the octonions that come after that. But that's the bottom of the list. I'm only going to focus on the first two rows. In fact, the whole lecture is going to be really about the first two rows. And in the first row, we have pi underneath it. In the column, you have a funny symbol. And if you're not Russian speaking, you don't know that how that's pronounced. So I'll tell you, I'm not very good Russian, but it's pronounced Zhuk. You've heard of names like Zhukov. That begins with zero. So that's the Russian letter. And I've drawn underneath pi because it is going to be the whole story of this lecture is about the relationship of pi with zero. You might think it's just a language problem. No, it's much deeper than that. So underneath the next letter, under gamma, I choose a letter in the Russian Aristotelian script. It looks a bit like it. It's, I think, pronounced zero. Doesn't matter, you see what it looks like. It's a nice letter. Underneath E, I haven't changed E. E is going to be the same in all languages. So E remains E, remains E. Okay, so that's a fixed point. Now, let's see how we're doing. I've got to correlate my talk, my slides, my pictures. It's quite a difficult operation. And my timing. Okay, well, that's what I've got more time than I thought. So, now, I think at this stage, let's try, if I go forward there, let's see. Have I got the lead groups there? Good, it all agrees. Well, I've got the lead groups because in the history of mathematics, one of the most important things we've discussed is group theory, and lead groups particularly play a very important role in geometry, physics, number theory, they are universal. And of course, as you heard, the person who first pressed for the existence of prize recognized Argo was Surface Lee. Surface Lee on the left, those of you had a beard, you see, of course. So he had a nice big beard. And he was a very good mathematician in his own right, so he created the theory of lead groups. Lead groups are called after Surface Lee. And alongside Surface Lee, people followed up and developed the theory. There was the famous French mathematician, Denis Cardan. And you see how beautifully trimmed the beard and moustache were. That was the days of gentlemen and gentlemen. And, you know, he's much better dressed than anybody here. But nowadays, standards have changed. You know, you say. And then on the right hand, the last person is this. It's one of my real heroes, the great Hermann Weyl. German mathematician, of course, very famous mathematics and physics, well known. Everybody, he was the sort of main pupil of Hilbert, and he ended up advanced study, which is where I was, but I have two rings, Sweden, but I did hear him talk. And I did hear him talk at the International Congress of Mathematicians in Amsterdam in 1954. Now, believe it or not, I went to that Congress. I was a second-year graduate student. Are there any second-year graduate students here? Well, I hope so. And I heard him talk because he was presenting field medals. Presenting field medals to Jean-Pierre Serre, who was the youngest field medalist ever, and is now the oldest field medalist. So he's been a field medalist from 28, he's now age 92. When you go some, you work out, it's a long time. He's still alive. He sent me my best wishes for his talk, and so he has, he also, by the way, the first Arbor Prize. So he has many rings. Anyway, that was a digression. Come back to him later. Anyway, Herman Weyl was a great leader, and I bowed before him, metaphorically speaking. Now, I'm trying to go back to the script. Let's see, where should I go next? Yes. Now, in all these formulae, there's one important formula of mathematics, the most important formula of all mathematics, the most beautiful formula of mathematics. You all know what it is. It's Euler's formula, e to the 2 pi I equals 1. It's a formula that has all the important symbols in it, e pi I. What more can you want? And that formula is a miraculous formula, as we know. It's sort of an I, it involves complex numbers. So Archimedes couldn't have discovered that because the complex numbers were not there. But once the complex numbers were there, Euler made this formula. It's the most beautiful formula in mathematics. And I like to compare it when I talk to people from other cultures with the most famous phrase in English literature, which comes from Shakespeare, and it's the phrase, to be or not to be. It's very short letters, very simple letters, but very deep meaning. And that is the literal equivalent of Euler's formula. Yeah, I think you can't disagree. The Euler's formula is so beautiful, so short. To be or not to be is, you know, one of the great short bits in Shakespearean world literature. So, I hadn't heard that before. I offer it to you to score it. Now, so E to the 2 pi is the most important formula in mathematics. Right, so now where do we go from there? Well, I'm going ahead of myself a bit, but let me go back to the table. So if I go back to the table, I can see the table, and so, yes, you can see the table too. So in that table, I told you that there is the top row at E, and then when you get the complex numbers in, you get I. So you write that Euler's formula. Now the row underneath it has other letters, which, what's the role of the other letters? Well, they are, in a certain sense, the top row has to do with the real complex numbers. The next row has to do with the quaternions. I don't know how much you know about quaternions, but they're invented by Hamilton.